we will get started. So, I am obviously not Gary Eller. I'm subbing for him this morning. He's out, but my understanding is that he's going to be back tomorrow. So, he'll be back next week, next Sunday for class. He'll be teaching again. So, I'm just filling in for him this morning. And based on the lesson plan for this quarter, Gary told me that we're going to be starting a study of Romans this morning. So we're going to go through Romans chapter 1 and Romans chapter 2. So normally when I'm teaching a class and you have the group of scripture you're supposed to go through, it's kind of topical. You know, there's a parable or whatever it is that you're going to be studying about or the Bible's talking about there. Romans 1 and 2 was felt a little bit different than what I'm accustomed to. So we're going to do, rather than study the topics necessarily, we're going to do more of a textual study this morning where we're just going to go through the scripture and kind of break down a couple of the ideas and talk about some of the things that Paul is saying here in the first two chapters. So anytime I start a study of a new book, one of the things I like to do is figure out, obviously for the context of the book, is who's the author, who was the letter written to, and what was the purpose. And obviously this is a pretty common approach because we want to understand the background of why the letter was written and to help us understand the motives and what's going on so that we can properly apply what's being taught. So obviously very first, starting in Romans chapter 1, the very first sentence out of the gate is, Paul, a bondservant of Christ, called to be an apostle, separated to the gospel of God, which he promised before through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures. So the book of Romans is written by Paul. From what I could see, it was written during his third missionary journey around 57 AD. And one of the things I still have not done, which I have always wanted to do, is actually make my own timeline at home about all of these things so you can kind of see it chronologically. But anyhow, the third missionary journey in around 57 AD to give you kind of a timeline of when this was written. A few purposes for the book, and we'll talk about here in a second some of this, but it looks like in the first chapter, Paul is trying to prepare the church in Rome, letting them know that he's planning a journey to go there. In verse 11, we're going to see chapter 1 that Paul wanted the church there to be what he called established, and which essentially means that Paul was wanting them to be well instructed or have a very strong, grounded faith. And then the third one, which you'll start getting a feel for here pretty quick, is that Paul wanted the Jews and the Gentiles to live in harmony. We've got to remember, historically, up to this point, the Jews were God's chosen people, and they were the special ones, right? They had a long history of having a relationship with God and being separate from the Gentiles, and benefiting from the covenants that God had made with them, and God had taken care of them, brought them out of Egypt, you know, taking them to the promised land, all of those things with all that history. So now, because of the covenant that Christ is setting up and the things that Jesus did, now things are changing, things are different. Not only are Jews able to be God's chosen people, but as Paul is going to start bringing to our attention here, it's also for Gentiles, which unless you're a Jew in the room here, that's all of us. That includes all of us. So good news for all of us, for sure. So verse 3, Paul says that he continues on and says, concerning his son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who was born of the seed of David according to the flesh and declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead. So verse 3, he mentions that our Lord was born from the seed of David. Now, why is this important to mention? First of all, back in 2 Samuel, if you want to turn to 2 Samuel 7, if you'll remember, God told David that he was going to make a covenant with him. And he explains in 2 Samuel chapter 7, if you look at verse 12, it reads, verse 12, "When your days are complete and you lie down with your fathers, I will raise up your descendants after you, who will come forth from you, and I will establish his kingdom." The very next verse in 13, "He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever." And then if you drop down to verse 16, it reads that "your house and your kingdom shall endure before me forever. Your throne shall be established forever." And so what God is saying here is that through your lineage, David was a king. And through David's lineage, God was going to create a kingdom through David that would last forever. So it wouldn't just be a physical kingdom, it would be an eternal kingdom. So God promised way back then that he was going to set this up. And then if you go, of course, to Matthew chapter 1, you'll see the actual lineage from Abraham all the way to Jesus, just as God promised. And we see that that actually came to fruition. And I counted it once. I think it's about 28 generations, which if you think about that, 28 generations, God was working to get to where he promised David he was going to get. And which is pretty impressive. So Paul here in chapter 3 is just confirming that. So it's important that for us to note, just as God promised, just as he said it was going to happen, Christ is in fact born of the seed of David, just as it was supposed to be. Before I move on, you'll notice no PowerPoint presentation. I was already told that this is not scriptural, and I'm probably in trouble for that. No, I'm kidding. But sorry for not doing the PowerPoint presentation. I'm subbing for Gary, I actually was a little bit behind schedule and wasn't able to put that together. So we're going to do it the old-fashioned way, go straight to the Bible, and we'll turn to those passages. And I'll try not to to bore you to tears without the presentation to help us follow along. But anyway, so verse 3, we learn about Paul's basically confirming what has happened. And it's a good reminder that God has followed through on his promise to David and that Jesus did come through his line, just as he said. Skipping down, so Paul talks about that through him we receive our grace and for our obedience, etc. And then if you skip down to verse 7, you'll see that Paul is writing this letter to all who are in Rome, the beloved of God, called to be saints. So Paul is writing to the church there in Rome. And as we're going to see here next in his greeting, Paul thinks very highly of the church there. Apparently the congregation there was well-founded, had some very strong members, and Paul was very proud of them. So you'll see in as you keep going down around verse 8, I believe, Paul says that he thanks God through Jesus Christ for you all, that your faith is spoken of throughout the whole world. That is a serious faith. Can you imagine if the faith of the congregation here was so strong, we were such a strong example of Christianity, that the whole world was aware of who we were and what we were doing? That is definitely the kind of example we want to be. That's the kind of congregation I think we should be striving for. But it's pretty impressive, and it's definitely quite a compliment to them. So Paul says, "For God is my witness, whom I serve with the Spirit and the gospel of his Son, that without ceasing I make mention of you always in my prayers." Now, I wondered about this when I read it. He says always. I wonder if Paul literally prayed for the church in Rome every time he prayed. And I'm sure for at least a span of time, Paul did. And in my mind, based on what we know about prayer, it's probably part of the reason that the church was as strong as it was, because they had their fellow brother praying for them regularly. And it's a good reminder for us to continue to pray for our congregation, for our individual members. I know for myself, you know, every week we talk about the prayer list or the bulletin, those who need prayers in the bulletin. And sorry to say, most of the time when I first hear those words, it goes in one ear and out the other because we hear it every single week. But pray for the people in that list. Pray for the people in our congregation, not only for the trials that they're going through, but their spiritual well-being, because in the end, that's the most important. I know that in the Valley congregation, there were a few folks that would literally take the bulletin and just go person by person. I'm sure there's some of you here that do the exact same thing. It's just a really good reminder that we need the prayers of our brothers and sisters, and that those prayers are fruitful and they do bring benefits. And I'm certain that Paul's mention of the Roman church and his prayers daily and as the scripture says, always, were a huge benefit to them maintaining their faith and continuing their walk as they were supposed to. So skipping down to, you will see around verse 11 that Paul was longing to see the church there in Rome. So it sounds like he hadn't yet visited the church. He'd only heard about them. He says that he would like to go see them because he wants to impart to them some spiritual gift. When I first started studying for this, I just read chapter 1, chapter 2, just read through it the first time, kind of get reminded of what the scripture was talking about. And then I go through and read it again and start picking out parts and then read it again and start detailing some of those parts. But the first time I read that, when I read impart a spiritual gift, I thought he meant literally give them some sort of, you know, physical gift. We've talked about in some of our classes how the apostles had the ability to perform miracles and then they could pass that on to someone. And I thought that's what it meant. But if you read a little bit further for the context, he actually explains what he's talking about here. So Paul's not literally talking about giving them some gift. What he says is, so that you may be established, that is, that I may encourage together with you by the mutual faith, both you and me. So I think the spiritual gift he's talking about here is more of an encouragement, establishing them. And I guess in the whole context, he could have given them some kind of physical spiritual gift, but it sounds like what Paul was looking for more was to encourage their faith and to be able to mutually benefit, both strengthen the congregation's faith and strengthen Paul's faith. Now, I have a question for you. What does it say about the Roman church if Paul, and I hate to overstate this, but the Paul that wrote all these books and performed all these things, and I mean, the probably one of the most devout men in the scriptures, is looking to go to Rome to get encouragement from them? That is quite, it says a lot, doesn't it? I mean, if Paul has that kind of, it says two things, first of all. Paul realized, even though he was the Paul, you know, the Paul doing all these great things, I mean, that had spoken to Jesus, you know, received instruction from Jesus directly, that guy still realized that his faith could be strengthened. So no matter if you're a newborn Christian who's just been baptized, or you've been a Christian for 100 years, your faith can always be strengthened. You can always be encouraged. And we should always be striving to be stronger. So Paul realized this about himself. And of course, Paul was humble. I'm not trying to overstate that. I recall the verse where he says he calls himself the chief of sinners. However, the fact that all I'm trying to illustrate is that Paul recognized the strength of the congregation there and recognized that he could be encouraged as well, not just Paul being there to teach them about the gospel, although that was one of his main motives to want to go, which we'll see here. So skipping down to 13, he says he lets them know that he's been trying to get down there and he's been trying to visit them for quite some time, that he could have some fruit amongst them. He talks about the fact that he's a debtor to both the Greeks and the barbarians. And he tells them in verse 15 that he is ready, as much as in him, that he is ready to preach the gospel to those in Rome. So Paul was eager to get there, to work with them, to teach them, to preach. and also to be encouraged by them. So the whole idea here, the first 15 verses of the book, very strong consideration for the work that the group was doing there in Rome. Paul is acknowledging how strong they are and encouraging them, essentially encouraging them to continue, looking forward to go down there and meet with them. Much, much different than some of the other letters in the New Testament. We've had a couple of studies about 1 Corinthians, for example. Completely different situation. A congregation that's really struggling with a lot of things, and Paul is really in their face about all these things, reprimanding them, and as opposed to here where Paul is like, wow, you guys are doing it great. You're doing it right. You're doing the right thing. Keep doing it. So quite a different tone here than some of the other books. So picking up in verse 16, Paul says, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, for the Jew first and also for the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. So Paul mentions the gospel here. He says that he is not ashamed of the gospel. We had a series of lessons on Wednesday night where Craig was talking about, at one point, the gospel. And the first thing that always pops in our minds, and as he said, rightfully so, when we say, you know, what is the gospel? It's the good news, right? It's an accurate description. However, as we see here, Paul describes the gospel specifically as something that has, that is the power of God, and that it is something that can bring salvation to everyone. And as Paul stated here, and as I mentioned before, not just to the Jews, not just to the people who had historically been the chosen people, but for everyone. There's this gospel that has the power for us to receive, or that can teach us to be saved. So the gospel is the power of God for salvation for everyone who believes. So everyone includes us, for sure. So verse 17, he mentions, or he has a statement in there, from faith to faith. And that was kind of a little bit of a challenge for me, from faith to faith. God is revealed from faith to faith. So what does that mean exactly? So when you're first, before you become a Christian, one of the things that is required for you to become a member of the church is for you to be baptized and become a part of the kingdom. One of the things that is required for that, of course, is your faith. You have to believe what is, you have to believe what you're hearing and what you're being taught and what you're reading. So your faith is initially required for you to begin your walk with Christ, to take him on in baptism. And once you're saved, the idea is you continue to study, you continue to learn, you continue to walk according to what it is that you're learning, and your faith is strengthened. So it's from your original faith that you began through the faith that you continue in as you go throughout your life. So it's basically through the whole thing, through your whole walk, from the beginning all the way through the end. And just as he says at the end of verse 17, that the just shall live by faith. So from your original faith and through you living by faith, that the righteousness of God is revealed. So one of the things that threw me off a little bit in going through this, so starting with verse 18, is you have this, through the first 17 verses, you have this tone where Paul is admonishing them, acknowledging them, encouraging them, basically recognizing their efforts. And then all of a sudden in 18, it felt like Paul just all of a sudden starts talking about God's wrath and all these terrible things. It was quite a transition in my mind where, you know, I love you, I pray for you every day, keep doing what you're doing. Verse 18, the wrath of God you know, and he starts going in. So I honestly didn't see much of a transition between 17 and 18. But obviously there's some things that Paul felt convicted to write the church about, whether there were a few members there that were struggling with that or folks in the area or whatever it may be. And we will see later that definitely there were some specific situations he's wanting to deal with the Jews. But what he's talking about here, why this is such an abrupt transition, I'm not really, well, at least it was abrupt to me. It may not feel as abrupt to you. But verse 18, Paul immediately starts going into the fact that God's wrath has been revealed against all ungodliness and all unrighteousness. So we'll just read the first couple of verses here. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and all unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness, because what may be known of God is manifest in them. For God has shown it to them. For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Because although they knew God, they did not glorify him as God, nor were thankful, but became futile in their thoughts, and their foolish hearts were darkened. So we see a section here where Paul is addressing the fact that even if you haven't had the opportunity to sit down with someone, or these guys hadn't, you know, been specifically preached the gospel, or you know, been taught whatever, just by the things around us, just by the things we see, the things that are made, the creation of the world, nature, we should know that there's a God. It's evident and it's obvious that this is not an accident. And God is telling us, Paul is telling us, that since the creation of the world, these invisible attributes, that they are clearly seen, and that by all this stuff that we're surrounded by, we can understand his eternal power and what it is. And one of the things I was talking about this morning on the way in with Tricia, with my daughter, if I seem a little bit slow, part of the reason is because Darren made me get up the other day at 5:30 in the morning to go hunt ducks. And don't fear, the ducks are perfectly safe. Nobody was harmed during the entire process because we are not very good at it. But I was talking to Tricia about this. You know, when you're out there, and I'm sure a lot of you guys are the same way, whether you hike or hunt or fish or whatever you do in this state, you can't help but think about God when you're walking around out there doing whatever you're doing. It's one of the huge blessings about being in this state, is that it just feels so magnificent. You just can't escape the grandness of the creation. And as you're walking around in it, you know, whether we go four-wheeling out there to Knik Glacier all the time, the magnitude of what you're looking at, the complexity of the universe, the way that everything works together. You know, I mean, we must have seen half a dozen different species of ducks out there, all of them beautiful in their own way, and obviously with the specific purpose and the specific way that they, you know, they behave every day, and the things that they do, the, you know, migrations and all those things. But it's so complex. It's so perfect. You know, and then past the world, as I said, the universe. I mean, the way that we're set up, the distance from the sun that we are, the seasons, the way they change, the way the ground provides the food that it does. There's no way that's an accident. And Paul tells us in Romans here, just as it was back then, the same is now. There's no way you can deny that. And he goes on to explain in verse 18, he actually says that some will suppress the truth. Well, if you're suppressing something, that sounds like a conscious decision to not acknowledge it, right? You're intentionally suppressing it. It's not that you can't figure it out. It's not that the evidence is not there. It's not that God has made this so confusing or so difficult for us to understand. Individuals are suppressing it. They're choosing not to acknowledge it. And in verse 21, he specifically says that those who choose not to acknowledge God, that you're without excuse. You can't deny it. It can't be denied just by looking around. I'm always reminded when I talk about something like this that of one of the smartest people in the world, and I, well, I'll just leave it at that. One of the guys who's considered the smartest people in the world, Stephen Hawking. When something leaves that guy's brain, it's the law, right? In general, to most of the world, he's the authority. And he's such a smart guy that we hang on every single word that comes out of the guys. And he is smart. He's a very intelligent man. Not taking that away from him at all. But he has struggled and spent such an enormous amount of effort in his career and his life to disprove the need for God. And this guy searches the universe, searches for these answers that obviously either continue to plague him, or it's such a big thing to him. Whatever the driver is, the actual driver, it's on his brain all the time. And he's constantly publishing articles about the fact that the universe doesn't need God, and he's, you know, this kind of Adam and this kind of deal and that deal. Why is it still bugging him? Why is he still searching for it? Why is he still, you know, spending so much energy on that? And the scripture tells us that that these efforts are futile. They're foolish. If you look in verse 21, although they knew God, they did not glorify him as God, nor were thankful, but became futile in their thoughts, and their foolish hearts were darkened. He's going to search his entire life, and the answer is right in front of him. And I don't mean to criticize him specifically, but as Paul says in Romans, it's obvious there is a God. Sigmund Freud was another one that struggled and fought with those things. And I need to move on. I had actually several other things I was going to talk to you about there, but it's futile. It's futile and foolish. And I think most of the people in this room, if not all of us, obviously we know that. If we didn't believe that this was not an accident, there was a creator, we wouldn't be sitting here. But if there's a way to, you know, help someone see that there's a creator by using nature or the universe as an example of a creator, then by all means, we should be doing that. So verse 24, he goes into some of the issues that mankind or the people were having. And he talks about how God gave these people over to their sin. One of the things I wanted to clarify here is, because that statement right off the bat seems, I mean, God giving them over to sin. God wasn't making them do this. What the scripture is talking about here is basically that God allowed them to follow their sinful desires. Nothing sinful or evil originates with God. However, he does allow us the free will to make our own choices. And in this case, there were some people who were, as the scripture said, decided to serve the creature rather than the creator. And God allowed them to be to follow those desires. So apparently they were focusing on physical things rather than serving God. And you could do a whole lesson just on the next few things that Paul talks about. The only thing I'm going to point out about for this, the sake of this lesson, is that God tells us Paul tells us what he was talking about here, where women exchange natural use for what is against nature. And he goes down a little further and says that, you know, likewise, that men were committing what is shameful, etc. So in a series of verses here, God calls these acts, lesbianism and homosexuality, God calls these acts vile passions, committing what is shameful, those things which are not fitting, just in this part here. And if you go to Leviticus in 18:22, the scripture reads, "You shall not lie with a male as one lies with a female. It is an abomination." God is the same God that he was in Leviticus, that he is today, that he will be a million years from now. To God, these acts are shameful. They are vile, and they're not fitting. They're unnatural. And as he said in Leviticus, it's an abomination. With that, I really struggle with how anyone can question exactly how God feels about those things. You just can't get there in my mind. No matter how much you read about love, no matter how many other scriptures you apply to those situations, you just can't get there. God doesn't accept it. Paul's very clear about that. And regardless of how things move socially in the world today, it's never going to be acceptable. It's just, I've run into several situations where recently as well, where, and you guys are aware of this, where if you disagree with that or you say something against that lifestyle or that, you know, whatever, that you're cruel, you're a bigot, you're unfair, you're unloving, whatever it is. But the scripture is clear. It's behavior that is not accepted by God. We have a friend, actually a coworker of mine that we met several times, a group of us to talk about scriptures. And one of the reasons that he grew up a Presbyterian. And one of the reasons within the last year or so that he actually stopped being a Presbyterian was because their board decided that they could have somewhere in their structure that they could have lesbian or homosexual individuals serving as part of their organization. And in his mind, how can that be? Because of the way the scripture says. But it's something that's pressing our face more and more. Obviously, we're always seeing about same-sex marriage these days and all that, all those things. But God is clear that this is not something he accepts or condones. So verse 28, a couple of things. Paul discusses what he calls all unrighteousness. Actually, that's in verse 29, sorry. He goes down and starts describing some of the things, all unrighteousness. And he lists a lot of really heavy things, a lot of really serious things that none of us would deny are obviously sinful behaviors. Sexual immorality, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, evil-mindedness, whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, violent, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, undiscerning, untrustworthy, unloving, unforgiving, unmerciful. Several of those things, you go through there and you're like, whoo, thank goodness I'm not a murderer. That's a tough one, right? I'm not full of envy. I'm not a hater of God. Nobody in here is a hater of God, right? Man, we're doing good. How many of you are proud? That's an easy one to slip in there. But if you look at that list, amongst the list, he doesn't break out proud or pride and say that that's less than any of the rest of the wickedness or sexual immorality or any of the other things that we would immediately say, ooh, I don't do that. Be on guard to not be proud. What about boasters? Boasting. Disobedient to parents. In the same breath that he's using words like sexual immorality, murderers, haters of God, unloving, untrustworthy, disobedient to parents is in that same list. And for all of us in this room, he doesn't give an age. Disobedient to your parents. Now, obviously they were very, I'll just leave that alone. Disobedient to parents, unforgiving. It is very easy when you are wronged to hold a grudge. And especially in the church where we hold each other to a higher standard, hopefully we're holding each other to a higher standard than the world. If you're wronged by a brother or sister, it's really difficult to let that go. But he throws that unforgiving in the same list with all those things we talked about. Just a really good reminder, keep your pride in check. Be forgiving. Forgive your brother. 70 times 7, whatever it takes. Always be forgiving. Stop boasting. I am the biggest boaster of all. I need to stop running my mouth and think about what you're saying and how you're behaving. Pride's another one. It's easy to be proud. We're just just a good reminder. He throws those in the same list with all the rest of those things. So that's chapter 1. Getting into chapter 2, Paul continues to talk about some of the things that are inexcusable, that are wrong. And right off the bat in chapter 2, he starts talking about how judging others is inexcusable. And I'm going to read this, what it says. Therefore, you are inexcusable, O man, whoever you are who judge. For in whatever you judge another, you condemn yourself. For you who judge practice the same things. But we know that the judgment of God is according to truth against those who practice such things. Now, what Paul is saying here is not that we are not to judge. And Paul does this to me all the time. The way he says things is, you got to break it down like 5 times to make sure you got it straight. But Paul is not talking about not judging here. What he says is, when they judged each other, they're judging themselves because they're practicing the same things that they are judging others for. So if I'm a thief, I can't judge you for stealing and not be judging myself because I'm also stealing. So by judging them, if I'm doing the same behavior, I'm judging myself. That's what Paul is saying. Along those lines, you know, the world loves to accuse Christians of judging, you know, because the Bible says we're not supposed to judge. We had some Wednesday night lessons several weeks ago where Ken covered this a little bit. But it's funny how the world wants to hold us to that standard, and they want to use the scripture against us, but they won't hold themselves to that same standard. But just to reiterate the points that were taught several weeks ago, the Bible doesn't tell us not to judge. Just straight out, don't judge. What it says is, the Bible says we're not to judge another's heart. You're not to judge something you can't know. You can rightfully judge someone's actions, and you should encourage and admonish your brothers or sisters not to continue in those behaviors if it's something that you can see and you know. If you know someone is having an affair, you're not judging them. You know that they're having an affair. You're confirming that behavior, and based on the scripture, you know that's not right. You're not judging them. But if you think someone might be a thief and you judge them and you have no idea, well, then you're judging the person's heart, or you can't judge their intent. You can't judge something you don't know. But recognizing behaviors that are unscriptural is not judging, and we should be correcting each other and helping each other. So my only point in going in all that is, just be sure that we're applying the scriptures correctly, we need to be sure we're applying everything correctly. So in this case, what Paul says is that the judgment of God is according to truth. So what he's saying is, in this case, Paul is saying that God's judgment is truth against the people who are practicing these things that he's talking about. The reason it's truth is because God is going to be judging the actual things that these people are doing, these actual behaviors. What they're doing is what they're doing, and God knows it, and he's judging that. So they're actually doing what they're being accused of, and they'll be judged accordingly, is what that is saying. So he tells us that in the days that are coming, that a day of wrath is coming for those with a hard heart. He tells us that God's judgment is going to be righteous. God's judgment will be righteous. And he tells us down a little bit further around verse 7, he says that judgment basically is going to be eternal life for those who are doing good, who are patient and doing good. And he tells us that righteous judgment for others is going to be indignation, wrath, tribulation, and anguish if you are self-seeking and you do not obey the truth. The wrath that's mentioned here is a future wrath. The wrath that we mentioned in chapter 1, verse 18, says that God's wrath is revealed. It's happening now. This wrath is a future wrath. And he says that for those who don't obey the truth, that they will receive all those things. Now, I'm running out of time, but very quickly, there's a huge difference between truth that's mentioned earlier in some of these other passages and the truth that Paul mentions here. We're not going to go turn to these because of time, but 1 Corinthians 16:3, the scripture reads, to be on alert, stand firm in... Oh, sorry, I'm going to skip down from here. I apologize. But stand firm in the faith, act like men, be strong. When you see the truth here, it's kind of like reading the faith in other scriptures. So the faith, not faith. I'm going a long way to get here. Just stick with me. When you talk about faith, it's your belief, right? What you believe. The faith is something according to the scriptures from what we read here you can stand firm in. In 2 Corinthians, we learn that the faith is something you can test yourself to see if you're in. And in Galatians, the faith is something that was being preached. So the faith, not your faith, but the faith is something that you can test yourself against, that you're in it. It's something you can preach, and it's something you can stand firm in. So it's different than just faith. Likewise, truth and the truth that is mentioned here is completely different. So in Romans chapter 1, verses 18 and 25, when God mentions, Paul mentions how they suppress the truth, or in 25 where he says that they exchanged the truth that they're talking about there was the evidence of God's creation. In Romans chapter 2, verse 2, when he talks about truth, that truth was the fact that those people were practicing the things they were practicing. The truth that he mentions in verse 8 is something that can be obeyed. So what he's talking about there when he says the truth, he's talking about the gospel. He's talking about that thing that was mentioned in chapter 1, verse 16, where he says, when he says that those who do not believe and obey the gospel, he's talking about the one that is the power of God for salvation to everybody who believes. So the truth here, if you don't obey that truth, you are not eligible to inherit eternal life. In fact, quite the opposite. For those who don't obey the truth, the gospel, for them, they have all of those things mentioned before to look forward to. Or I don't mean to sound flippant, not to look forward to. They have that. They will receive that punishment: the indignation, wrath, and tribulation. There were several other things I was gonna try to get to. I guess the last thing, we only have about 2 minutes left, but if you skip down to the end of chapter 2, around verse 24, chapter 2, verse 24, Paul is talking about how the Jews considered themselves to be teachers and instructors for everyone. And, you know, Paul has been trying to strengthen the idea with them that that the gospel is available to Jews and Greeks. And it sounds like the Jews that were teaching here were a little bit arrogant or proud about some of this. And Paul tells them, basically, you got to practice what you preach. So don't preach you can't commit adultery and then you are committing adultery. And in verse 24, he says, for the name of God is blasphemed amongst the Gentiles because of you. And this was a really powerful scripture for me when I was studying this. There's a Christian band called DC Talk, and they have a song called What If I Stumble? And the introduction to that song is a guy who was preaching a lesson. It sounds like an old recording that they started before they go into the song. But what that guy says is pretty impacting. What the quote is, he says, the greatest single cause of atheism in the world today is Christians, who acknowledge Jesus with their lips and walk out the door and get on with their lifestyle. That is what an unbelieving world simply finds unbelievable. I don't know that Christians are the single greatest cause of atheism in the world, but the point that you can get from that quote is that the world is watching us. We have to be mindful that we're not doing what Paul is saying at the end of Romans here, especially if we're teachers and instructors, but all of us have the same obligation to live not just on Sunday morning like we preach or like we teach, but the world is looking at us as examples of what a Christian is. And I'm sure you know this, but you are held to the highest standard in our world that there is. And the world is seemingly more impacted by our mistakes than anybody else's. I say that only to encourage you to not just be a Christian on Sunday morning, but to be a Christian 24 hours a day, all week long, in front of other Christians and in front of your friends who aren't Christians and in front of the world all over. Because the last thing we want to do is be the reason that the world is blaspheming Christ. So thank you for your attention. Gary will be here next week, and we'll see you guys in a little bit. Thanks.